Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rediscovering Travel, A Guide for the Globally Curious by Seth Kugel. Read by Kyle Tait. Chapter 1. Rediscovering Travel. Stenciled in white block letters on a dreary cement wall in Mezubareni, a tidy but fraying town of 12,000 in the hyperbolically named Great Hungarian Plain, appeared the word Sesfuzda. Hours earlier, in the overcast pre-dawn hours of a nippy January day, I had stumbled off the Bucharest to Budapest train to see what it would be like to spend the weekend in the opposite of a tourist destination. Mezubareni was not just absent from guidebooks. It did not have a single restaurant, hotel, or activity listed on TripAdvisor, something that cannot be said for Barara, Uganda, or Dalanzatgad, Mongolia. I did have some info on the town, thanks to its municipal website. Resident Josef Hollaz had recently celebrated his 90th birthday. Or that's what Google Translate told me. Hungarian is a Uralic language, more closely related to the output you might get falling asleep on a keyboard than to English or German or French. That makes even basic comprehension a challenge, as I found as soon as I rushed from the train to the station's restrooms and faced the urgent need to choose between two doors, Ferfi and Nui. The authorities had apparently saved a few forints by not splurging on stick-figure signs. The day had been born cold and gray, and stayed that way as I walked through the town, slowly getting my bearings, intrigued by the pre-war, pre-communist homes and the more than occasional bike rider. There were almost more bikes than cars, who waved hello. But then a winter drizzle took up, causing an abrupt decline in the number of cyclists, even as the number of wandering American visitors held steady at one. To me, a travel day that turns rainy is like a piece of chocolate I've dropped on the floor. It's significantly less appealing, but I'll be damned if I'm going to throw it away. It was in the first minutes of rain that I came across the stenciled sign on an otherwise residential street. Beyond the wall, down a cracking, now puddle-pocked driveway, were a dozen or so plastic barrels lined up like nuclear waste drums. Beyond them, maybe 100 feet from where I stood, was a one-story L-shaped building. What was this place? Well, says Fuzda, apparently. But what was that? In the old days, say 2009, I would have pulled out an English-Hungarian phrasebook or pocket dictionary. But instead, I activated international roaming on my phone, carefully spelled out S-Z-E-S-Z, F-O-Z-D-E, and tapped Go. The less-than-lightning speed of Great Hungarian Plain mobile service provided a dramatic pause. And then came my answer. Distillery. You don't say. I would have guessed private property, maybe. Or danger, stay out. Or mind your own business, you meddling foreigner. But a distillery? A wave of adrenaline washed down my torso as my lips curled into a dumb-luck smile. Two rather gruff-looking men emerged from the door, the older one smoking a cigarette and wearing a sweater and work-stained trousers that suggested Warsaw Pact 1986 more than European Union 2014. I waved to them, pointed to the bulky Canon 7D hanging from my neck, and then to the building. Old-school Google Translate. They waved me inside and gave me a tour. Even for a travel writer, the idea of landing in a small town with no known attractions and no known English speakers, where I had not a single contact and no idea where I'd be sleeping, was nerve-wracking. The fact that I had to write a first-person column about the experience for the New York Times a week later added to the pressure. In 3.5 years as the Frugal Traveler, I had never been shy about pointing out my shortcomings. If my weekend in Mezubareni was a miserable failure, the world would know. I had been an unlikely choice for the column to begin with. As a longtime freelancer for the Times, I had written almost entirely about New York City. Of the dozen or so destination stories I had been assigned, most were about the Dominican Republic, Mexico, or Brazil, countries I knew well and where I spoke the language. The two exceptions were Philadelphia, where I also spoke the language, and Curacao, where I did a great job of lying on the beach. For a job in which dinner party acquaintances and Twitter followers alike expect you to spout infallible advice about Roman ruins and Tokyo takoyaki off the top of your head, I was pathetically traveled. I had never set foot in East or South Asia. I had spent a total of a week in Europe since my junior semester abroad in Paris, 19 years earlier. Even in the far more familiar Western Hemisphere, I was a renowned bungler. My first column recounted how I almost had to cancel my debut trip after leaving my passport on a men's room paper towel dispenser in the Sao Paulo airport. Someone turned it into Lost and Found, thus saving my trip, and perhaps my career. Though plenty wrote in to ask how such a numbskull had gotten the job. According to my editor, I was chosen because he liked writers who traveled, not travel writers. I had spent the previous 2 years covering every corner of Brazil as a freelance correspondent. But introducing yourself as a reporter makes travel far easier, grabbing people's attention and opening many doors. The Frugal Traveler column is different. Under strict orders from my far wiser predecessors, I didn't tell anyone I met on the road that I worked for the Times or that I was even a writer, until afterward if I needed to use their names. I was expected to make friends and have adventures on the basis of my own extroverted personality. And though I am extroverted, quite so, in fact, among friends or speaking to a crowd or interviewing a source, striking up conversations with strangers for no reason whatsoever always felt to me like that first jump off the dock into a cold New England lake. Even by the Hungary trip, 4 years into the job, approaching strangers still made me nervous. But at least I had raised my game from utterly pathetic to awkwardly mediocre, and had learned that Mezubereni was just the kind of place where jumping into the lake would likely pay off. One of my most ironclad rules of travel is this. The number of visitors a place receives is inversely related to how nice locals are to those visitors. Mezubereni, as far as I knew, had received precisely no foreign tourists ever. It was the anti-Paris, in this distillery, the anti-Louvre. People who inhabit the still plentiful tourist-free swaths of the planet tend not only to be just nicer, but more curious. They say a bear in the wild is just as scared of you as you are of it. I say people in places where outsiders rarely go are just as curious about visitors as visitors are about them. The question is not why the distillery workers invited me, a camera-toting, gibberish-talking stranger, in for a tour. It's why wouldn't they? If it were me, I'd be thinking, what is this odd foreigner doing outside our Sesfuzda with a camera? Wait till I tell the kids. And by the way, isn't it about time we took a break? Once they waved me into the ancient but fully functioning distillery, the men let me take pictures as they gave me a vaguely intelligible lesson via pointing, expressive looks, and smartphone-translated Hungarian on how palinka, Hungarian fruit brandy, was made. Those barrels I had seen outside, it turned out, were full of fermenting pear and grape and apple juices. Inside, it was distilled somehow through a looping, entangled system of pipes running out of tin tanks up and along the walls. It looked like the laboratory of a mad scientist with a penchant for tacky linoleum flooring. As they led me around, I engaged in that most intrinsic of travel activities, trying to see the world from the vantage point of someone utterly different from me. What was their life like? Had they traveled? Who were their parents and grandparents? The language barrier that did not allow them to answer did not stop me from wondering. I also hoped to engage in that second most intrinsic of travel activities, souvenir hunting. So I asked to buy some brandy. What better souvenir than one that comes with a story? But they refused to sell me any, or even let me taste a drop. In another setting, perhaps, this would have annoyed me. Here, it created a whiff of intrigue. Was my request culturally inappropriate? Had they simply not understood what I wanted? Did their bosses keep such a close watch on the inventory that they would notice a missing nip? After soaking in every rusty detail and every glint of pride in the men's tired eyes, I typed, "Come visit me in New York," into Google Translate. Laughs all around. Then headed back onto the drizzly streets of Mezzubarani, utterly elated. What was so great about this moment? Sure, the Sesfuzda was a neat little story for friends, and in my case, worth a few paragraphs in the newspaper. But wasn't it just a grimy business making local hooch in a town that even most Hungarians would classify as the middle of nowhere? It was because I discovered it. Not a discovery in the sense of a cure for AIDS or a previously undiscovered species of poison-spitting neon frog the size of a pinky nail. Perhaps it was not earth-shattering, but it was 100% unexpected, 100% real, and 100% mine. Discovery used to be the lifeblood of travel, at least for those who shunned tour bus groups and all-inclusive resorts. We used to leave home knowing relatively little about our destination, perhaps with some highlighted guidebook pages denoting major attractions and local tipping etiquette, a list of tips culled from well-traveled friends, or articles copied and pasted into a Word document. And for the ambitious, a notional feel for the local history or culture gleaned pre-trip from a historical novel. Beyond that, we were on our own. Paper guidebooks frozen in time helped us along, as did pamphlets and paper maps from tourist information booths and tips from a hotel concierge. Earlier this century, Google searches in internet cafes lent a hand. But otherwise, there was no choice. You decided what to do with your own eyes and ears, by wandering, by initiating human-to-human contact. Tips came from hearing fellow travelers' stories over hostel or non-Airbnb breakfasts, entering a shop to ask directions and ending up in a conversation with the owner, or catching a whiff of fresh bread or sizzling chilies and following your nose. Of course, all that still happens today, but only if you really go out of your way to make it happen. Not only is nearly every place in the world documented to within an inch of its life, but that documentation, which comes dressed as both fact and opinion, is overwhelmingly and immediately available thanks to pervasive technology. That's great for many things in life: medical information, how-to videos, shorter commutes. But don't we travel to break our routine? To experience the unexpected? To let the world delight us? If we do, we have a funny way of showing it. We pore over online reviews for weeks, plan days down to the half hour, and then let GPS and the collected wisdom of the unwise lead us blindly. We mean well. No one wants to have a romantic dinner go wrong, or to get lost and miss out on a must-see attraction, or to risk chaos by failing to keep the kids entertained for 3 minutes. But isn't that just a digital version of the old-fashioned group tour? Well, almost, except that on the bus tour, you actually get to meet the person whose advice you're taking. That's why I believe it is time we rediscover travel and recognize the value of what an over-documented world has taken away: the delight of making things happen on your own. Is it possible that stumbling upon a dank distillery might be just as thrilling as a tour of one of the world's great monuments? Did the surge of emotion I felt when the word distillery popped onto my screen match what I felt when I first glanced up at the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel? Probably not, although I remember the distillery moment quite precisely and barely recall what I felt at the Sistine Chapel. Why? Because although Michelangelo's prophets and sibyls and biblical recreations are several trillion times lovelier than rusty pipes in a concrete building reeking of fermented fruit, I had seen them before in photos, heard professors talk about them, and read other travelers' accounts as I sought the best times to avoid crowds. Expectations were high. At the Vatican, anything short of a life-changing epiphany would have been a disappointment. And it's pretty hard to have life-changing epiphanies while surrounded by crowds pretending to have life-changing epiphanies. It was, of course, a worthwhile experience, and would have made for incredible Instagram fodder if only I'd gone a few years later. But by now, the live experience has merged with the images implanted in my brain long before my visit, and after via hashtag Sistine Chapel. Why the Sesfuzda workers wouldn't sell to me was a mystery. In fact, it was the third mystery I had encountered during my first 4 hours in town. The first came moments after I relieved myself in the Ferfi room in the Mezzubereni train station and emerged into the misty morning. On a sign outside the station was what appeared to be a tourist information map. Its very existence was unexpected. If TripAdvisor wasn't here, could tourism exist? But the more confounding issue was why the welcome messages were written in three languages, none of which was English. Willkommen gave away one as German. Kusuntu, with its overload of diacritical marks, had to be Hungarian. The third language's greeting was Pozdravenie, which I didn't recognize at all. This completely fascinated me. German, I knew, was a second language in much of Central Europe. Hungarian, of course. But what was the third language? I didn't think I'd ever seen a trilingual tourist map anywhere in the world where one of the three languages wasn't English. A few taps of the smartphone, and the answer emerged. Slovak. Come again? Slovakia bordered Hungary to the north, but Mezzubereni was much closer to Romania to the east, where my train came from, and even Serbia to the southwest. Mystery number one remained unsolved. There was another surprise. Spread across the map were 39 points of interest. I didn't know what any of them were, since I can't read Hungarian, German, or Slovak. But there was clearly more to this little town than you'd ever think from its dot on the map and its forlorn train station with stick-figure-free restrooms. I had been tricked into assuming that if the English language internet didn't have much to say about a place, nothing was there. I did recognize one word on the map, right in the center of town. Salo, hotel. That was good news. I snapped a photo of it to find my way there. Few people were out, giving me the chance to observe the town before it observed me. Like many travelers, I find the first few moments in a new country or city strange and disorienting. Things look and sound and smell different. Humans dress different. Sometimes even the dogs bark different. The neurons start to fire in the part of your brain that handles, "We're not in Kansas anymore," circumstances. And there's an added touch of excitement or panic when you have no guide, no language skills, no hotel reservation, and no idea what is going to happen, if anything is going to happen at all. Every little detail helps. A scrap metal heap? There's some industry here. A sign that reads Cargill behind a barbed wire fence? There's probably something agricultural in that warehouse. Closer to town, the agro-industrial started giving way to residential and even commercial. I saw an iterem, a restaurant of sorts, so I knew I wouldn't starve. And wait, were those Bike lanes? That was most unexpected. I had erroneously associated bike lanes exclusively with places like Scandinavia and Holland and Portland, Oregon. Why would there be bike lanes in small-town Hungary? Wait, why would there not be? Was I suffering from anti-ex-Soviet bloc prejudice? A left turn at a traffic circle brought me past a cryptic sculpture of three girls huddled together on the right, a supermarket on the left. And beyond was surely the most majestic edifice Mezzubarini had to offer, a two-story mansion with elegant arched windows and a Juliet balcony over a carved wooden front door. The Barini Sallo. And then, something else unexpected. Though it was not yet 7 a.m. and still just before sunrise, two young men were drinking beer by the entrance. I greeted them and found they spoke English surprisingly well. Had I underestimated the provinciality of the town? No, not yet, anyway. They turned out to be medical students visiting from Budapest, in town for a pig killing. Promising. I began to drop hints that I would like to be invited. "But the pig is already dead," one said. They were back for a break. That jibed with my limited knowledge of ritual pig slaughters. Get them killed early so that their many component parts can be dressed and cooked over the course of the day, much of it for immediate consumption. Pork is my weakness. In the past, my online dating profile has read, "If pork shoulder were a vegetable, I could be a vegetarian." And immediate is my favorite kind of consumption. But in the time it took to reserve a room for the evening and leave my bags in storage, the medical students had disappeared, perhaps to stuff sausages. That was depressing, but also instructive, I thought. In many parts of the world, an out-of-place foreigner would have been instantly invited to join. Were Hungarians different? Or perhaps, I should say, more like New Yorkers? The whereabouts of this pig killing became mystery number two. Looking for it struck me as an excellent excuse to walk around town, after stopping by the local bakery for a black kávé, a rare decipherable Hungarian word, and a chocolate snail pastry. I asked the drowsy woman behind the counter, who got by in English, whether there was anything interesting to see in town. She answered with a look. "Nothing?" I interpreted. "Nothing." Even without evidence to the contrary, there was a pig killing somewhere, plus quite a scrap metal heap. 11,000 people glommed together anywhere must, by the very nature of human society, have created something that outsiders perceive as interesting, even if those who live there do not consider it so. A family's laundry drying on a clothesline, for example, can reveal the locally prevalent style of undergarments. So I set out walking around town, sniffing for roasting offal, assembling bits of information, and waving to people on bikes, most of whom were elderly, though I wasn't sure whether that meant the elderly of Mezzubarini like to ride bikes, or that no one else is up before 8 on a Saturday. Actually, many dogs were up, greeting me from front yards with the friendly yips of the small-town canine. Rural dogs bark frantic alarms, and city dogs are far more nonchalant. And then, eventually, I came to the Sesfusda, where the refusal to sell me palenka became the third mystery of the day. A little more wandering brought me to a place called the Burger Box, whose sign read 0 to 24 non-stop. Hungarian was getting easier by the minute. A burger place is always a good spot to see just how far American values have penetrated other lands. And by American values, I mean ketchup, mustard, and relish. None of those words appeared on the undecipherable menu. I recognized only paprika. It was the perfect excuse to talk to the lone other customer, a 40-year-old man named Gabor, who told me in remarkably good English that he had stopped by for a snack on his way to German class. I probably should have asked how his Slovak was, but instead I inquired about which burger he was having. "I make myself," he said, meaning he custom ordered. I asked him to order too, and we chatted. He was excited to hear I was from New York, which did not surprise me. People are so excited to meet someone from New York that I often recommend that anyone from within a few states away introduce themselves as, say, from Pennsylvania, which is near New York. But Gabor had actually been there. I asked him when.
Bin Laden.
2001.
Yes.
Before or after?
I saw the hole.
I asked him where else he had been. Washington, he said, a reasonable choice for a tourist. And Richmond, Virginia, he added. Not so much. It turned out he had gone to the United States on a whim and ended up working for a housekeeping service in Richmond. The burger was terrible, the kind of grayish ground meat that could push anyone closer to pork shoulder excluded vegetarianism. But if one of the reasons we travel is to better understand how the world works, then meeting a former Richmond, Virginia housekeeper eating a custom-ordered chili cheeseburger on his way to German class is to me just as good as any critically acclaimed museum. I'd given up on the pig slaughter, so after bidding Auf Wiedersehen to Gabor, I figured I'd go to church. Not for the reasons tourists usually go to churches, to feign interest in frescoes and icons, and not for spiritual guidance, but to meet people. As a secular Jew, I've been to synagogue maybe a half dozen times in my life. A wedding here, a bar mitzvah there, once to interview an Argentinian rabbi in the Bronx. But as a lone traveler, I've been to church dozens of times, because church is the most intimate part of people's lives that is open to the public, and welcoming by mandate. You shall treat the stranger who sojourns with you as the native among you, and you shall love him as yourself, says Leviticus chapter 19, verse 34. And in my experience, Christians of every stripe follow that to the letter, as long as you catch them in services. I found a Catholic church on the way back to town, but Mass wasn't until 5 p.m., almost 6 hours away. So I kept walking and stumbled across the town museum, the OPSKK Museum Collection, in an old-fashioned, very yellow home. It was my lucky day, or more specifically, my lucky 2 hours. What seemed to be the town's most legitimate tourist attraction was open only on Saturdays from 10 a.m. to noon. The museum was no Louvre, but you could take that two ways. It was not 1/1,000,000th as impressive, but it was not 1/1,000,000,000th as crowded. And unlike the staff at the Louvre, which is polite because politeness is in their job description, a young wispy bearded man named Jolt was downright thrilled, or perhaps shocked, to see me. I was, he said in halting English, the first guest in 3 weeks. He waived the entrance fee, out of kindness, I thought at first, though in retrospect it must have saved him from some sort of accounting procedure at the end of his shift, and took me on a tour. There is not a soul listening to this book who cares about Mezubareni's history. Don't lie. Nor did I until I arrived in town. But now I was eager to hear anything that might help figure out this place. The house where we stood, Zolt told me, was once the residence of the family who had helped rebirth the town in the early 19th century. It later became a school, and then a library, before becoming a museum. In the backyard was a memorial to Mezubareni's Jews, taken away during the Holocaust and never heard from again. Inside, Zolt showed me an exhibition of work by a local embroiderer, and some wacky artifacts, including an ancient, enormous water carbonation machine, a refrigerator-sized soda stream. Finally, we entered an area full of more quotidian objects, including a four-poster bed, household goods, and family portraits. It was the Slovak room, he said. Aha! Slovak! That could not be a coincidence, but Zolt's English didn't prove up to the task of explaining. I returned to the church at 4:54 p.m. and found the gate locked, lights out. Finally, an older woman opened the doors and people started to filter in, mostly her non-English-speaking demographic. A young organist greeted me in English, but she soon disappeared to man the pipes. I had settled in, still mildly uncomfortable, when 3 20-somethings took a pew a few rows in front of me. Target spotted. Once Mass ended, I made a beeline for them and was delighted to find that their English was excellent. One had recently graduated as a lawyer, another was an economics student at the English language Central European University in Budapest, founded by George Soros. I asked them about the town history, eager to pick up where Zolt's English left off. They obliged. Sometime before the end of Ottoman rule in 1699, the original town was destroyed. An 18th-century effort to repopulate brought in not just Hungarians, but Germans and Slovaks. Mystery 1, check. They gave me a restaurant recommendation for that night, a spot on the edge of town, Topart Vendiglu, that I could never have found myself, and they suggested I take a bus to some famed thermal baths in a nearby town. Eventually, I told them about my visit to the Sesfujda and asked where I could buy palenka. Balázs, the economics student, said the place to get good palenka was actually his godfather's house. "You know," he said, "I am thinking we should go knock on his door and see if he has some to try." Funny, I was thinking the same thing. There is no better travel moment than being invited to someone's house in a strange, faraway land. So we went and knocked on the door. After a lengthy delay, Zuzi, his godmother, answered, frumpily dressed in furry slippers and seemingly exhausted despite the early evening hour. Balázs translated. "She asks you to pardon her appearance," he said. "She was at a pig killing early this morning." I asked Balázs whether there were normally multiple pig killings on Saturdays. He asked Zuzi. "She says this was one with some doctors from Budapest." It had occurred on a farm outside of town, which made sense and meant my search had been futile. Mystery 2 solved. But I did score an invitation to come back the next day to buy some palenka from István, Balázs's godfather. I said goodbye to everyone, walked to the restaurant, and ordered the house special pork croquettes and a soup. The meal was nothing to write home about, much less mention in a book. Let's just say it was heavy and Hungarian, and the noodles in the soup strongly resembled maggots. But the waitress, who was chattily stretching her English to the absolute limit, mentioned that the place was also an inn with 3 bedrooms upstairs. She insisted I see them, for they were special. Each was decorated in the style of one of the ethnic groups that founded the town: Hungarian, German, and Slovak. She also told me that the statue I had seen downtown, the 3 huddled girls, represented the unification of the 3 groups. It had been an extraordinary day. A pre-dawn arrival, a mysterious tourism sign, a scrap metal heap, a missed pig slaughter, a distillery tour, a burger with a new friend, a museum all to myself, and all before noon. Then Catholic Mass, a history lesson, an invitation to buy palenka, a traditional dinner with maggot pasta, and a tri-national bedroom tour. The next day, I set off to the famous bathhouse my new friends had recommended, which was pleasant enough, though the highlight was successfully navigating the 2-leg intercity route via the Hungarian public bus system. Afterward, I was really looking forward to my visit with István for my first mule-kicking slug of palenka, but it was still bugging me that the Sesfujda staff wouldn't sell to me. This time, the family was more prepared for visitors. István sat me down with some appetizers and then brought out his wares, in plastic bottles with felt marker drawings indicating the fruit each spirit was made from. Plum, grape, pear. But we were unable to converse at all. Zuzi, no longer in furry slippers, tried to communicate with me in German. Surprisingly, my viewing of World War II movies had equipped me to understand that their son was coming over and that he spoke English. The son, István Jr., István Schmoll, his dad explained with a brief and adorable stab at English, arrived with his wife and their five-year-old, who wore a powder blue scarf with Hello Kitty, or at least a member of the same litter, on it. Meeting cute local kids is vital to the success of every trip. I tried on her scarf, which she found funny, though not nearly as entertaining as her discovery that she could speak to me in Hungarian, and I could not understand her. I must have been the first foreigner she had ever met. Not so István Schmoll. He had lived for a year in Georgetown, South Carolina, making him an able translator. The conversation suddenly got quite sophisticated. Zuzi was a retired schoolteacher and wanted to know about the American education system. She had heard that high school students in the United States could skip certain subjects if they wanted, and she was appalled to hear I had skipped physics to take introductory Spanish. I asked them about life in the Soviet era, and they recalled getting their news from the Voice of America. Then I asked to see where István distills his palenka, assuming he was hiding a small moonshine-style still in a shed out back. "Oh, he doesn't make it himself," said the son. He explained that István ferments fruit juice in barrels and then takes it to a sezfuzda, which finishes the job. And yes, it was that sezfuzda. The workers wouldn't sell me palenka, it turns out, because it was not their palenka to sell. The family invited me to a pig killing the next day, but I was due back in Budapest for my flight home. It turned out a weekend was not quite enough time to see Mezubareni. It's not everyone's thing to get off a train in a random Hungarian town and poke around for a few days. One person's adventurous weekend is another's 48 hours alone and confused in Hungarian Hicksville, sitting through an incomprehensible mass and hopping a public bus to a thermal bathhouse. What if I hadn't happened to stop by the museum during the only 2 weekly hours it was open? What if there had been no hotel? You might even wonder what I found so appealing about a grungy local distillery. If I were so into spirits, why didn't I take the Buddha Bike Lake Valença Wellness Tour, which stops off at a palenka distillery, includes a free tasting, and is conducted in English? Even more guaranteed would be a distillery tour back home. A press release I received a few years back from Sugarlands Distilling Company in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, made a double first on TripAdvisor claim. It leads all U.S. distilleries in 5-star reviews with 2,831 and was currently ranked as the number one thing to do in town. Sorry, Ripley's Aquarium of the Smokies. You can even try all 14 flavors of their moonshine, such as blueberry muffin and maple bacon, just as they did during Prohibition. 14 flavors is 14 more than I tried at the Sezfuzda. Could 2,831 five-star reviewers be wrong? Not only is the Sezfuzda not the number one thing to do in Mezubareni, it is not even one of the 39 points of interest on the Hungarian, German, Slovak map at the town train station. And though you're practically guaranteed a pleasant, seamless experience at Sugarlands, I can absolutely not guarantee that you'll be invited into any old Sezfuzda you come across in small-town Hungary. But of course, that's not the point. I wasn't even looking for a distillery. It was something that just happened on the way to not finding a pig killing. Well, I made it happen by forcing myself for the 1,000th time to wander unknown streets, to tolerate uncomfortable moments, to thrive on unprocessed experiences and unvarnished attractions. Admittedly, Hungary was not the first country where I had sought out a TripAdvisor-free town to visit. I had taken similar detours in Mexico, where I spoke the language, and Turkey, where hospitality levels are culturally off the charts. And both had gone great. Mezubarani was an uber test of my discovery-based travel philosophy, a choice most travelers would not entertain, given their paltry vacation time, limited budget, and yen to see London or Rome or Yosemite National Park or the Great Wall of China. That's perfectly reasonable. But even a tiny push towards spontaneity and discovery can improve just about any trip. Even to destinations where the scales are tipped toward footstep following and pre-chewed adventure. Still, every tiny push is tough. Even for me. Even closer to home. Even where I speak the language and know which restroom to use. In 2013, I decided to rotate the classic coast-to-coast American road trip 90 degrees and drive from Baton Rouge, Louisiana to Fargo, North Dakota. The idea was to linger in the states that most cross-country road trippers sped through. By one late afternoon in Kansas, I was behind schedule, worried about ticking off the long list of attractions and historic towns on my way to the bison herds of the Flint Hills, when I noticed a sign on the side of US 75. Livestock auction, 6 p.m. My thought process went something like this. 1. Never been to a livestock auction before. 2. No, I've got too much ground to cover, and the hotel room I reserved is still hours away. 3. I'll miss some great stuff tomorrow, and my whole trip will be delayed, and maybe I'll miss the bison, and this article will stink. 4. It's probably a boring event anyway. By this time, I have driven 1 mile past it. 5. But on the other hand, random stops have often worked before. I should be adventurous. 6. Or should I? Will I dare talk to anyone? I'm a middle-aged, strangely dressed New Yorker. I don't fit in there. 7. Oh my God, I will be so uncomfortable, and then I'll regret wasting my time there. And the time I lost will mean I'll have less time to see bison, which could be a life-altering experience. 2 miles past it. 8. But wait. The worst that could happen is I would be delayed half an hour. It's boring, I leave. Why am I being such a loser? I turn around, head back, park my car, and nervously walk in the entrance. 9. Oh no, everyone is looking at me. I'm such an outsider. 10. What should I say to meet people? How about, I'm not from here. Can I ask you why those kids are parading cows around the ring? After several false starts, I finally managed to approach someone. He was friendly and curious about what I was doing there. Others joined us, and I became a sideshow, as the good people of Coffee County explained the cow parade. It was a highlight of their county fair, a premium auction in which bidders did not actually buy the animals, but essentially donated a cash prize to the young participants, 4-H members ages 7 to 18, who had raised them. The kids marched the steers and heifers, don't call them cows, city boy, around a ring to the mesmerizing slur of an auctioneer's call. I stayed only an hour or so, but it was so fascinating that days later I would divert from my route again to attend 2 county fairs in Minnesota, and then devote a column and a video to them. It has since become a staple of my travel advice that county fairs are one of the greatest travel destinations in the United States for anyone from a big city. Or even better, another country. When foreigners ask for advice for a summer trip to the United States, I always tell them there is nothing more American than a county fair. Of course, there have been trips where following my adventurous instinct turned out to be a cockamamie move that ruined the day or even my whole trip. For example, okay, so there was the time... Wait. I can't even remember a single time. That's not because it always works out great, but because if it doesn't, what have you lost? An hour? A day? At worst, a weekend? And most of the time, it does work out, because the world is an interesting place, and people are generally nice, and even something half-good becomes great when you discover it yourself. And something half-bad can turn into a story you can tell for years to come. When I urge you to rediscover travel in the coming chapters, it may sometimes sound like I'm nostalgic for a pre-smartphone, pre-TripAdvisor, pre-baggage fee world. But this is not an anti-travel industry or anti-technology screed. So many advances have been essential to and have greatly facilitated our ability to travel the world, and I'll get into them all. The explosive growth of airlines and sinking cost of fares over the last half century have given exponentially more people the chance to travel, albeit uncomfortably. Technology used right is as much of a boon to travel as technology used wrong is its bane. Companies harnessing the sharing economy have brought travelers closer to the places they visit by helping them stay in real people's homes, connecting them to local events, and finding them independent tour guides. Sustainable travel initiatives have helped stem the impact of the travel hordes on our fragile environment and often even more fragile local cultures. And innovative tour operators have allowed us to see far more of the world than would have been possible or safe in the past. Still, no matter how many well-meaning cogs there are in the international travel machine, the more you can replace them with the billions of normal people just living their lives out there, the better. They are the unwitting tour guides to our best travel experiences. Chapter 2. Organic Experiences. I usually allotted 4 days of travel to a column. Sometimes, when things went right, I gathered plenty of material with a day to spare. That happened in July 2011 in the city of Gaziantep, Turkey, just 30 miles from the Syrian border that has since become embroiled in a refugee crisis. Back then, however, the city was simply the under-the-tourist-radar center of Turkey's pistachio industry. For someone with a sweet tooth the size of a T-Rex incisor, i.e. me, this can best be understood by its residents' formidable per capita consumption of honey-drenched, pistachio-studded baklava. After 3 days there, I had gorged on the stuff. But I also scored a tour of the Pistachio Research Institute by posing as a traveler fascinated by pistachios, and even managed to make a few people laugh with my inside knowledge that the Turkish word for pistachio, fistic, was slang for an attractive woman. With a free day before my flight from Gaziantep to Istanbul, I decided to rent a car and drive 90 miles east to the city of Şanlıurfa, home to famous bazaars and thought to be the birthplace of the biblical Abraham. When I realized that much of the highway bisected pistachio groves, I felt the same nagging curiosity as when I pass a cluster of Bangladeshi immigrant businesses in Queens, or a small village on the Rhine, or a farmhouse along an Iowa highway. Who's there? What are their lives like? If I stopped in right now, what would I discover? Usually, I keep on driving. Not only do I often need to be somewhere, but what would I say to these people anyhow? Even after years of finding myself in unfamiliar situations, my instinct is to avoid chatting up strangers. But this time, suppressing self-doubt, I turned onto a dirt road that led, according to a sign, to three towns: Balika, Guzelkoy, and Entepe. An effectively drawn symbol warned the route would be bumpy. I was suddenly in a different world, jolting past orderly rows of bushy green pistachio trees rooted in soil that crumbled in the piercingly dry heat. Balika came first, and I wish I could say it was a picturesque village where gray-haired men drank tea in an Ottoman-era cafe in the shadow of an intricate 17th-century mosque. Instead, Balika was one of those drab villages that perpetually disappoint those novice travelers whose romantic notions of poverty come with thatched roofs or carved sandstone or artisanal brick rather than cement block. Not a single human appeared, just agricultural equipment rusting alongside the road. There was not even a store where I might strike up a chat with the owner. Despite its name, Beautiful Village, Guzalkoy was equally unattractive, but at least there I encountered a live person emerging from a house. Spotting some turkeys, always fun to see in Turkey, pecking about, I got out of the car to take some photos. The man gave me a suspicious look and wrote down the number of my license plate as though I were a spy. Which, in a sense, I was. Goodbye, Guzalkoy. My luck changed at Intepe, which was slightly bigger, about 500 inhabitants, I would learn later, and a bit less ugly, but not much. This time I got out of the car to take a picture of some wandering geese. Really, just an excuse to see if anyone would talk to a total stranger taking pictures of geese. A man approached. "Hello," I said, then broke out my sparse Turkish vocabulary. "English. No Turkish. Tourist." He was more interested in me than in my license plate, and thus began one of those improvisational sign language conversations that are somehow decipherable, though it mainly consisted of pointing to my map and over-enunciating the words camera and tourist. Here's the translation into spoken conversation. "Nuvaram. My name is Nuvaram. What are you doing here in Intepe?" Me. "I am a tourist named Seth. I was going to Şanlıurfa, saw this town on a map, and decided to come to take photos of Fistic." Nuvaram. "Are you hungry? Come to my house to eat." Me. "Nuvaram, what a generous surprise." I acted surprised, but I'd been angling for just such an invitation. Intepe had the same cement block feel as Balika, but Nuvaram's property was an antidote to the drabness. He led me through a carefully tended garden, past pomegranate trees and a hammock, and into a living room without furniture. Rugs covered the floor. Scarlet cushions inlaid with intricate patterns lined the walls. And I felt what many first-time visitors to New York City report when they catch a glimpse of Fifth Avenue or stroll through Central Park. I had stepped into a movie set. Of course, you don't need an invitation to gain access to New York. Manhattan is a 22.8-square-mile film set. That's a good thing, because I doubt that if you see Robert De Niro on a Tribeca street, a few words of halting English and a few gestures will get you invited over. Though it's worth a try. So the feeling of stepping into the Denaulu family home, heck, walking by his pomegranate trees, was every bit as thrilling to me as taking in Niagara Falls or Notre Dame de Paris. What was lost in grandeur was made up for by admission into the family sanctuary of someone with such a vastly different life experience. I was in a place I couldn't have imagined that morning, or even 1 second before I entered the property. It used to be that entering regular people's homes depended on the luck of bumping into generous souls like Nuvaram. But these days, many tour operators and hospitality services offer processed versions of such experiences. That's not always bad. I've stayed in Airbnbs around the world and entered homes from Swaziland to Rio de Janeiro on organized tours. But it's not the same for two reasons. First, because I had discovered the house. Second, because Nuvaram didn't know I was coming, hadn't been paid, and didn't even have time to alert his wife or family. This is his house, as it always was. And presumably, my arrival was as much a novelty to his family as their home was to me. It was, in other words, an organic travel experience. These days, we mostly associate the term organic with food. But to me, a shift toward discovery-based travel would have an obvious parallel with the organic food movement. Both push us away from consumption of processed products provided by an industry that does not always have the best interests of the customer at heart. The organic food movement is, in part, an effort to go back to the time before hormones and pesticides and GMOs and factory farms and corn syrup and food processing plants. In many ways, organic food is what we used to just call food. But now we go out of our way, often at great expense, to eat the way we used to. Travel is not so different. A few years ago, it wasn't unusual to spend a morning wandering about a foreign town with no smartphone to tell you what to do, no service to create authentic experiences for you, and no particular goal in mind except to let discoveries happen. Today, we take fewer risks, often shying away from unsupervised adventure. The parallel isn't perfect. Traveling organically doesn't cost more money. In fact, it costs less. But it does cost planning time, and even harder, requires courage. Then again, eating organically takes courage, too. You have to give up regular Doritos. Doritos are terrible for me, but I love them. Why? Because some food engineer found just the right combination of salt, oil, cheese, and chemicals to sprinkle on a tortilla chip, so that when I put one on my tongue, my brain lights up with pleasure. Organic food is often more expensive, harder to find, not nearly as shiny and beautiful, and occasionally much less delicious. But it's better for you in the long run. And a century of technological and culinary advances has made healthy eating far more enjoyable. Few, if any, Americans were downing quinoa with coconut water in 1990. Let alone in the 19th century. And knowledge of nutrition has advanced, even if some pay it little heed. Farmers of the 19th century wouldn't recognize today's farm-to-table organic meal as their food, any more than the Chinese recognize the sesame chicken lunch special with pork fried rice down the block from my apartment as their native cuisine. The travel industry, too, has developed cheaper, mass-produced products to be as tempting as possible to consumers, sometimes disregarding what is good for them. That has allowed more people to travel, just as more can afford mass-produced snack foods. And just as I still eat Doritos, I'm sure I'd also like the comfort of a bus tour that picks me up at my hotel at 9 a.m., and is led by a charismatic, knowledgeable guide who has processed the city into digestible chunks, with a dash of travel MSG. It's easy, it's delicious. There's nothing wrong with a city tour once in a while, but it's bad for you in excess. Unlike Doritos, it will have no detrimental effects upon your health. Instead, it will just mean you missed a potentially better experience. Many travel companies now realize they've gone too far to homogenize experiences and have set out to reverse engineer spontaneity and fun that should come organically. Some large hotel operators even delve into their guests' social media accounts to create such delight, which became a travel industry buzzword a few years ago. Here's some advice for the hospitality industry from an article on the site sproutsocial.com. It is quoting a Hyatt Hotels Corporation social strategy and activation specialist. Pay attention for details that might explain why your guests are staying with you or opportunities to make someone's stay special. The specialist then describes what happened when staff at one Hyatt noticed that a guest had posted a sonogram from his wife's recent doctor's visit. They scrambled to put together a package of various beers, bacon, and other snacks with a handwritten note to congratulate the father-to-be. Here's how I see that playing out. Hey, Jim, how was your trip? Great. I was missing my wife something fierce. But then my hotel spied on my social media accounts and sent me some bacon. It was like I was back with my family. Nothing wrong with food corporations or startups or ministries of tourism or tour operators offering consumers what they want, but also nothing wrong with consumers rejecting those offers. And even if cooking at home is a luxury you don't have the time for, A vacation may be the only time of your life when you have complete control over every hour of your day to plan or not plan as you wish. Traveling organically is certainly more challenging. My communication with Nuvaram and his family would have been far easier with a guide to interpret, for example. But though conversations without one can be strained and less substantive, they have their own appeal. Even the most minor mutual understanding can bring smiles, and conversation always leads to efforts to find shared humanity rather than conflict. So the two of us spoke about Turkish food, and that I listed the dishes I had tasted and rubbed my stomach to indicate I had loved them. Other members of the family trickled in, his veiled, traditionally dressed wife, Perian, and then their adult children and grandchildren in Western clothing. It turned out to be school vacation, and the extended family was in from the city. Then came the food. A heaping plate of Turkish rice, grilled chicken, wafer-thin bread, tomato and cucumber salad, two plates of spicy green peppers, and no silverware. I realized it was all for me, and I tried with hand signals to gather everyone together to eat with me. No luck. And thus, the show began. Live from Entepe, foreigner eats Turkish food. Will he like it? Will he finish it? Of course he won't. I complimented Perian profusely for her cooking wiles and gave the international hand signal that guests seeking mercy from excessive generosity have long employed. If I eat all this, I will become fat. They all laughed, because when someone who doesn't speak your language makes even the worst joke, you must laugh. It's in the UN Charter. Hand signals can only go on for so long, so the kids fetched their English class notebooks. First came the same conversation travelers from English-speaking countries have with eager beginning English students around the world. You. Hello. Kids. Hello, how are you? You. Fine, thank you. How are you? Kids. Fine, thank you. How are you? Cracks me up every time. Then they continued. What is your name? Where are you from? How old are you? Until the vocabulary well ran dry. So we moved on to an area of international interest that does not require speaking the same language. Soccer stars. They gave some names. Messi, Cristiano Ronaldo. And I gave my opinion. An uninformed thumbs up. I was impressed they had heard of American forward Landon Donovan, though this was only a year after the 2010 World Cup in which he had scored 3 goals. Then I showed them the photos I had taken in Gaziantep. Digital photography is a great advance for telling people who don't speak your language about your trip. Impressed with my camera skills, okay, probably just with my camera, they brought in a set of great-grandparents, 172 years evenly split between them, to be photographed. One boy could say just 2 things in English, perfect, and I love you. But he stretched their usefulness impressively. Entepe, perfect? He asked me. Evet, I replied. Yes, in Turkish. Then, Turkey, I love you? Again, evet. And, America, I love you. Seth, I love you. I'm welling up now just thinking about it. Not because it was an intercultural kumbaya moment that portended world peace, but because it was a clever linguistic effort by a smart kid using his limited tools to get a point across. And I'll bet it was thrilling for him to make himself understood in a language he hears only in school and perhaps on YouTube. The inflow of grandchildren and cousins continued as the afternoon went on, and among them, virtually every minute of the visit was captured on cell phone video. Eventually, I was led to the house next door, home base for the musical side of the family. One of Nuvaram and Piriyan's sons broke out a stringed balama and sang. And then the kids took me on a tour of the town and neighboring orchards. Our exploration ended only when we reached a ridge and they stopped me. We could not go on, for there were snakes beyond. There are snakes beyond, by the way, is a very easy concept to get across even with no shared language. As I finally left around dusk, I got big hugs, kisses on the cheeks, and I love yous from the boys. From the girls, handshakes. I had skipped out on Shanlurfa, undoubtedly a marvelous city that I hoped to visit someday, but had no regrets. Instead, I was thinking about how clearly I would remember the experience, and almost certainly recount it to many people for years to come. I was sure Nuvaram, Piriyan, their children and grandchildren would remember the experience just as vividly, and tell many people about the tourist who wandered into their little dot on the map and spent the afternoon. When we take an organized tour that includes a visit to someone's home, or stay with a family on a homestay, or rent a room through Airbnb, we have come into contact with card-carrying members of the tourism industry who have, to a greater or lesser extent, packaged the world in the way they think we want to see it. The homes may be real, but the activities are transactions. The sellers are exposing their lives for money, like some sort of cultural stripper. My visit to Nuvaram's family house, on the other hand, had to be the event of the month or year, even, for all of us. And it proves that organic, discovery-based travel does not require heading to an unknown town for an entire weekend, though I'm apparently not against it. I risked at most an hour by turning off a highway down a dirt road lined with pistachio groves. But even if that seems...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.